and stand and prepare to worship the Lord together. Father, our God, we just humbly come before you this morning, Lord. Thankful for your Son, the promise that you gave, God, that we are saved by your Son, that we can put our hope and our trust in him, and God, that that you are mighty. So, Lord, as we just celebrate this day, we just pray that these songs will be sung with hearts overflowing with praises for you and your name, and God, that you'd just be mindful to give you the praise, honor, and glory in all things that you're working in our lives. Thank you, Father, for this time. We ask that you bless it. Just be with us. Thank you and love you. We ask this in your Son's holy name. Amen.
See, on the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. Flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice. What he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done.
Even death is dead. His life is overcome. Say the name of all the names, over every
Tree. From heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes, to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cost, for even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. The stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tomb, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. For his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. In the love of Jesus Christ,
bounds of space and time, and fashion worlds to his design. The one whom angels most revere, among the stars like chandeliers, numbered every grain of sand. Father, you are King. You are Lord, Savior, friend. Father, we just thank you that we can just gather together in your name this morning. God, we thank you for your Son, the ultimate sacrifice. God, just praise your name forever and ever. We love you, Lord. Ask you to bless this time and prepare our ears, hearts, and minds and continue to worship you in your word. Thank you, Father. Say this in your Son's holy name. Amen.
Amen. Remain standing. I'd just like to read from Psalm 34. It says, I will praise the Lord at all times, and I will constantly speak. I will bless the Lord. Let all who are helpless come, let us know the Lord's greatness, and let us exalt his name. I pray to the Lord, and answer me. All my those who look to him for help will be redeemed. No shadow of shame will come to me. I pray in the blood of Christ, who saved me from all and he surrounds and defends
please let me know. Just want to welcome all those who are visitors, and we welcome you in the love of Christ. And this is your place. This is your place to come and dwell. We wanted to just give you guys a little taste of life at the Falls here as the worship continues throughout the week. As we mentioned here, Sunday is just a pep rally. Your worship service begins on Monday when you go to work, when you go to school. And we are a church that longs to be in fellowship with one another. And the way that we do that throughout the week is there's various opportunities to gather. We just wanted to share that we have a Tuesday night study that meets here down in the basement. They provide dinner, so if you guys are interested in that, there's Tuesday night available for you. Wednesday night, the women meet together at Katie Coyner's house. If you guys are interested in that, please reach out to either Ryan, myself, and Katie. She's working out in the children's, or you can ask one of the women. I'll point somebody here. Tisha would know. She's in the back. She'd be glad to help you figure out where that's at. And men, we meet here in the sanctuary at 7 p.m. on Thursdays. We provide opportunities from within these groups to then break off into what we would call life groups, where we get to actually work out our Christian lives together as we share our struggles, as we ask for prayer, as we confess our sins, and as we just do life with one another. So that's what we want to be, and we want to be a church that's known for being and making disciples. So we welcome you guys to that. Right now, we're gonna give you guys an opportunity. I know it's kind of weird, maybe if it's a new time in church, but we just wanna allow the time for you guys to fellowship with one another and welcome one another. So please take time right now for that. Also, for those that call this place your home and you call the Falls Church your church, another way that we worship, and we worship in song, we're gonna worship in listening to the word, but we also worship in our giving, and it's whatever you feel pressed to do unto the Lord. I just want to make you aware of the two ways that we have available today is in the back. We have a box that's marked offerings or gifts, and then we also have, if you go to thefallschurch.com, there's a giving portion where you can give electronically as well. I'd like to pray for those gifts right now and for our service, and then we'll let you guys fellowship with one another. Father, we just thank you so much for this joyous day that we have, Lord. The fact, Lord, that you came, Father, and you promised a way for us to, Lord, be made well, Lord, to be made whole before a holy God. That us sinners would be able to be in relationship with a perfect God. And Lord, in the fact that you came and you lived the perfect life and you died on the cross, Lord, but most importantly, you rose again from the dead, validating everything that you have ever taught, ever promised. And because of that, Lord, we have hope today that we can be reconciled before a holy God. So we rejoice in that. We rejoice in our songs. We rejoice in the eagerness to hear from what your word has to speak to us. And we rejoice, Father, and we give you all things. And Lord, I pray for the gifts and offerings that are given, Lord, to this church, that you, Father, provide wisdom to the leadership to handle those appropriately, Lord, and that you grow this church, Lord, to be the church that you want it to be. Lord, this is your church. And Father, we thank you today. Lord, we pray for those that were not able to make it here, Lord, due to illness or whatever the circumstances. Lord, may you bless them, Lord, and may they become aware of your presence even now. We give you this time together, and we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you guys, say hi to one another.
It belongs to you. For me, who can be against me? Yeah. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. To you, in every fear I lay at
and I'll get started reading the scripture for today. And if we could remain standing for the reading as well. Sorry. All right, good morning, church. Please take out your Bible and remain standing for the reading of today's scripture, Mark 8, 27 through 38. Mark 8, 27 through 38. Jesus and his disciples left Galilee and went up to the villages near Caesarea Philippi. As they were walking along, he said, Who do people say I am? Well, they replied, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say you are one of the other prophets. Then he asked them, but who do you say I am? Peter replied, you are the Messiah. But Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. Then Jesus began to tell them that the Son of Man must suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of the religious law. He would be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. As he talked about this openly with his disciples, Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Jesus turned around and looked at his disciples and then reprimanded Peter. Get away from me, Satan, he said. You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. Then, calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message in these adulterous and sinful days, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in glory of his Father with the holy angels. God help us be hearers and doers of your word.
He's risen, church?
Amen.
That was good. Well, we can do better, though. He is risen?
He is risen.
Awesome. Well, it's good to be with you. Thanks for joining us this morning. For those watching online, good to have you with us. Sorry you couldn't be here in person. Man, I'm like teared up, actually, just watching that. So give me a second to regroup. We We've been working through a series in Galatians ever since basically our winter series started, and so through spring. But obviously during Holy Week, we took a break, and we had Sam preach last weekend on the triumphal entry and really looking at Jesus' kingship and what his kingdom and what his kingship actually looks like, which was so different from what everyone who was there might have hoped or expected for. But obviously God knows best, and he wasn't here to establish an earthly kingdom, but an eternal kingdom. And then thank you for those that joined us on Friday night for our good service, our Good Friday service. That was really beautiful, just celebrating and reflecting on the fact that Jesus did not have his life taken from him as a victim, but we really looked at the fact that he willingly went to the cross on our behalf. And Jesus said, paraphrasing here, that no one takes my life from me. I give it up freely so that you may live, so that you may have life. And this morning what we're going to look at is we're going to look at a few different passages where Jesus is telling in advance his followers, his disciples, and those who are hanging around him what is to come. And I want us to listen to this stuff through the ears and through the eyes of us being a follower, maybe a wanderer, maybe a skeptic. All of us fall into one of those categories. And listen carefully to what did Jesus have to say, and why was it so hard for his disciples to actually hear what he was saying and really understand it? See, we have the benefit of hindsight. We have the entire scriptures. We have church history. And we can look back and it becomes much more clear. But for the disciples, they are walking in the moment with Messiah. They recognize he's Messiah, just as the passage we just read, but they don't really understand the full implications of that. So that's what we're going to work through this morning. On a little bit lighter note, happy Easter, everybody. And hopefully you get some time with family, with friends, and also in reflection. I don't know if it's a good decision or a bad decision to do kind of like a winter dad joke series, and I can't decide if it's still winter or not. Seems like it won't let go. So you're going to get maybe one. But the thing is, as I was looking for jokes, I want to make sure the jokes I tell are excellent. And I couldn't find any that were very bunny. So we're just going to move on. Resurrection Sunday is a season where we celebrate new life in Christ because Christ overcame the grave. The tomb is empty. Amen? And his resurrection is not just a part of the Christian faith. I would say that it is the pivotal, foundational anchor of the entire Christian faith. Said another way, if the resurrection didn't happen, then what makes Jesus any different from Gandhi or Muhammad or some other person that gathered unto themselves while they were alive a following? They gave teachings that spoke to what was going on in that day and maybe even hold some significance and even some truth for generations to come. But last time I checked, Gandhi and Muhammad are still in the grave. We know that there were earthly rulers, kings, not just prophets like those guys, but kings who called themselves God and demanded that people under their rule called them deity. We know this was true of the Egyptian pharaohs. We know this was true of the Roman emperors and many other throughout church history and empires that none of us have really studied. But this is common, that man would elevate himself to a godlike status. They're all still in the grave. And not only that, every one of their kingdoms has crumbled. Not one of them is still standing. There is only one historical figure who was a priest, a prophet, and a king that made fantastical claims that are actually backed up by what he said and by what he did. Anyone can make claims. Anyone here can make a claim. I can make a claim. How do we know whether something is true, though? Well, it stands the test of time. There's eyewitnesses, there's evidence, all these sort of things. the Bible itself testifies that after Jesus' death, which was a public spectacle, mind you, there was people from all over the country and the surrounding nations that were in town for the Passover, that were eyewitnesses to what happened to Christ. Not only that, after the death, burial, and then empty tomb and resurrection, we have documentation in the Gospels, as well as in the book of Acts, that Jesus appeared to his disciples, his followers, and is up to many as 500 eyewitnesses. As if that wasn't enough, though, we could take a step back and go, okay, well, maybe the Bible is testifying to itself. That's not a valid, complete argument. What about the fact that our entire human history is calendared by the life of Christ? See, there was witnesses that are documented in Scripture, and then there were witnesses that scattered back into all of their nations that they came from. And as the gospel spread, they would have been there to bear witness to what they saw with their own eyes and what they witnessed. If this was fantastical, if it was simply a myth, there is a very low likelihood that Peter, James, John, Paul, go on down the list, that they all would have taken it to their own graves, literally being martyred and killed just because they thought Jesus was a good teacher. Highly unlikely. Possible, yes, but 11 out of 10, plus all the early church, it's highly unlikely that that many people would go to their death for something that wasn't true. At the end of Mark, if you would, just close your eyes and listen to this for a minute. This isn't going to be up on the screen. I just want you to listen. This is how Mark ends his gospel, chapter 16. We're going to read the first few verses here. It said, Saturday evening, when the Sabbath ended, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and Salome went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way there, they asked each other, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb? But as they arrived, they looked up and saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. The women were shocked. But the angel said, do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body. Now go and tell his disciples, including Peter, that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee, and you will see him there, just as he told you before he died. The women fled the tomb, trembling and bewildered, and they said nothing to anyone because they were too frightened. Then they briefly reported all this to Peter and his companions, and afterward Jesus himself sent them out from east to west with the sacred and unfailing message of salvation that gives eternal life. Amen. Let us pray together. Father in heaven, Holy Spirit, Christ who is on the throne, we gather this morning to celebrate you defeating death, you ransoming us, you fulfilling your word. And God, I'm just trusting that in this moment, God, you have a word for every person here. You say in your word that your word will not return void. So I pray this morning that no matter where anyone is at on their journey with you, that they would hear the words of Christ, that they wouldn't hear my words, they would hear your words, Lord, and that you would challenge them, that you would comfort them, that they would also sense your love and your invitation. Church, would you just pray to God right now? God, teach me this morning. Speak to me this morning. Help me to know Jesus Christ more personally and intimately this morning. We commit this time to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this morning what we're going to do, in addition to the passage I just read to you, we're going to look at three different passages, of which one was already read for you. Thank you, Troy. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at each of these passages. And it was really interesting, as I was preparing for this sermon, I had an idea of where I was going to go with it. And that's not where it went. We're going a little bit different direction. And so if it's good, God gets the glory. And if it's bad, I must not have heard him very right. But as we're exploring these three accounts, I want us to as best we can, try to put ourselves in the mindset of trying to, again, hear and see what is Jesus trying to teach the disciples that is so contrary to their paradigm and our paradigm. And the reason this is important is that if Jesus really did rise from the grave, then what he said must be taken serious. He validated his authoritative teaching by doing what no one else has ever done and probably will never do again. By probably, I mean like 100%. Pretty good odds. So we looked at this first passage, and I'm not going to read it again for the sake of brevity, but you'll notice in your notes, does everyone have an outline? That this is outlined with basically three things at the bottom of each of these passages. Okay, there's a prediction given by Jesus himself from his very lips. There's an understanding from his disciples who are listening that is a wrong understanding or an incomplete understanding. And then Jesus takes a moment to correct them in love, not for his own ego, but for their benefit. Don't we want to know what Jesus has to say for our benefit this morning? We see here in this passage that we read that Peter comes before Jesus and rebukes him for what Jesus had said. And what Jesus had said was that he was going to be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. That's what Jesus predicted, and Peter rebukes him. And then Jesus turns around right back at Peter and says the following. This is verse 33. He says, "You have a wrong understanding, Peter. I must carry through what I told you is going to happen for you. I'm not going to the cross, and I'm not raising from the dead because I need one more thing to do. I'm not going to suffer and be betrayed and beaten because I need saving." He says, I'm going to do these things, Peter, because I love you. And you are unable in your own strength and in your own power to comprehend these things, but more importantly, to live up to the standards of a perfect and holy and righteous God. And so I will do this for you. And all I'm asking is that you trust and obey. And as I invite you into a relationship based on love, you would respond by faith. So Peter is stained by sin. He's unable to ransom or save himself. Again, Jesus' rebuke is from a place of love. So the right understanding is what Jesus says in verses 34 through 37 then. He says, "In order to follow me, Peter, you must be like me." Well, what does that mean? Jesus says you must deny oneself, take up your cross, and follow me. Friends, is this not the hardest thing for us to do? Who here wants to carry around an object of torture and suffering? Why is my hand the only one up? Come on, guys. We all want to do this, obviously. Of course we don't. Right? How about this? How many of us enjoy denying ourselves? Like, you know what I'm doing today? I'm just going to do a whole bunch of stuff that I know I don't like to do. And I'm going to avoid giving myself all the things that I really enjoy. Isn't that like just the opposite of our nature and our flesh? This is why fasting is so important as a spiritual discipline. I'm learning to deny myself and my flesh. Other spiritual disciplines. Sunday morning, simply getting up and coming into the house of God. Getting up in the morning, beginning my day in devotion and prayer, when all I really want to do is drink coffee and read the news maybe. Right? This last week, our men's group was meeting here on Thursday night, the one that Sam announced, and we're talking about this idea of prayer. And even when we're talking about prayer, one of the things that we were discussing is, outside of one in the group, I think all of us agreed, most of our prayers are like totally selfish. Right? They're very me center. What's really helpful is when we get together with other folks, it seems that our prayers and our emphasis actually really changes onto others. But I'll admit, if you look at my journal, a lot of prayers for self. And that's not a bad thing. I'm just making a point that Jesus is saying, hey, the normal, natural human condition is to really be focused on self. But if we're looking at God's eternal kingdom, one that hasn't crumbled, is still building and will last forever, it is built on the very model of Jesus of denying oneself unto the benefit of others, unto the glory of God. But just as important, Jesus is God. He is creator, and he knows it's actually what's best for you and for me. Amen? In Matthew 6, Jesus was basically correcting a lot of the teaching that had happened over the previous generations, coming from the scribes and the Pharisees and their interpretation of the law. And during this, Jesus says directly to the listeners, he says, hey, do not be anxious about your life. He says, God is in control. He knows you, he loves you, and just like he provides for the birds of the air and the flowers of the field, you can be assured that he cares for you and loves you and has a plan for you and all these things more than for the birds and the flowers. You can take it to the bank. Jesus then issues a warning. And this is something we all need to listen to. We can say, okay, I don't know if I'm really willing to deny myself, but at least I'm not gonna go step on Jesus' toes because I want to stay kind of friendly, but I'm not gonna give up my life. I'm gonna stay in control. I'm gonna do what I want. I'm gonna be Lord of my own. And Jesus says, that's not an option. He says to them, do not lose what God has for you by trying to save your own life. Is anything worth more than your soul? He asked them. Is there anything worth more than your soul, friends?
No.
But in the moment, that's so hard for us to remember, isn't it? We can be so very grateful that Jesus practiced what he preached. Jesus did not try to save his own skin, even though he could have. Instead, he picked up his cross and he followed the will of the Father. The plan that brought pain and suffering to Jesus, but the forgiveness of sins and the peace of God to Peter and to each one of us who respond in faith. So I have a question for us as we sit here, and this is really a little bit more interactive. Sometimes I'll do this in a service, but we're going to move through a few different passages, but I just want you to stop and reflect on this for a minute. There's a space there in your notes. And maybe just do some reflection, pray to God, and ask him, God, is there anything that I'm holding on to this morning that you would desire to set me free of? Maybe it's my ego. Maybe it's my understanding of how things should work in my own understanding. Maybe it's some earthly ambition. Maybe it's some expectation that you've placed on God. And until he meets it, I don't know what it is. But I'm trusting right now that the Holy Spirit's working and that he would work in each of you. And just ask that question, God, is there anything in me that I'm holding on to? Because I don't want to lose my soul. Lord, I want to be a follower. I want to be a disciple. I want to walk in your footsteps. I don't want to miss what you have for me. God, help me see what I can't see, or help set me free from that which I'm holding on to. Just take a moment and say that prayer to God, would you? So moving on, that was in Mark chapter 8, and that was the first time that Mark records Jesus speaking forth that he was going to die and suffer and then 3 days later be raised from the death. That was the first time the disciples heard it from Jesus' lips. Here we are in Mark chapter 9, and let's read this passage. It says, leaving that region, they traveled through Galilee. And Jesus didn't want anyone to know he was there, for he wanted to spend more time with his disciples and teach them. He said to them, the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of his enemies. He will be killed, but 3 days later he will rise from the dead. Verse 32, they didn't understand what he was saying. However, they were afraid to ask him what he meant. After they arrived at Capernaum and settled in a home, Jesus asked the disciples, what were you discussing out there on the road while we were walking? I inserted that part about walking. They weren't in a Tesla. What were you discussing on the road, he asked them, but they didn't answer because they had been arguing. What about have they been arguing? About which of them was the greatest? He sat down, called the 12 disciples over to him and said, whoever wants to be first must take last place and be servant of everyone else. You see, what's going on in this scenario is that Jesus, Mark moves really, really quickly through his account of Jesus' life. And basically, if you read the first, 10 chapters of Mark or something, it's just, and then, and then, and then, and then, and then, and then. Very to the point, very direct. And he's marking just, Jesus did this, Jesus did this, Jesus did this, Jesus said that. But what you see building through all of this is this anticipation that the disciples are expecting what Sam touched on last week, is this triumphal entry at some point where one of two things is going to happen. Jesus is going to overthrow the occupation, the corrupt religious systems and all of that, and restore a kingdom like in the time of David, or he's going to get killed. Because what would happen if we stormed the Capitol right now? Ever thought about that? That's what Jesus is essentially doing. He's coming saying, hey, I've got a kingdom I've come to establish. It only goes one of two ways. You win or you lose. You win, you're crowned king, your followers are what? They're elevated to positions of honor. You lose, off with their heads with yours. Fair enough? We've all seen the movies? It's kind of how it goes. So the disciples, they're listening, but they're not hearing. Jesus is saying, yes, we are headed to Jerusalem. Yes, I am here. Peter, you even just testified it in chapter 8 that I am the Messiah. We're coming here to establish a kingdom, but it looks different than your expectations. They're not hearing that. And instead, on the road, Jesus, being all-knowing and probably having, what the equivalent of 20/20 hearing is. Is there a number for that? Did I just make that up? It's like one of those thoughts. You're like, I just thought of that. Okay, circle back. That was to me, not you. I'm like, focus. He hears them, and Mark makes it very, very clear that Jesus knew what they were talking about. They knew what they were talking about. And what they were talking about was found in verse 34. And Jesus called them on it. And he says, what were you discussing on the road? I'm curious, friends. They must be utterly embarrassed at this point. And they did not answer. Why? Because it says right there, they've been arguing amongst themselves. How are we going to sort out this kingdom when he's the king? How do we all fit in to helping rule? Aren't we lucky that we are going to, that God chose us when we were just out there with our fishermen nets, cleaning the scales off of fish, ripping people off as a tax collector, working with our hands, and now we're going to be basically right-hand men to royalty. And Jesus is like, hey, I know I'm talking, not sure you're hearing. Please listen. He says, whoever wants to be first in my kingdom must willingly, must readily, must have a heart posture that will take last place and not only tolerate being a servant, but seek to be a servant of others. So what's the prediction? Mark 30, or 9:30 through 31, Jesus says he'll be betrayed unto his enemies, killed, and 3 days later he will rise from the dead. Say, what, Jesus? What's the wrong understanding? Well, clearly in this one, they heard him, but they didn't know what he meant, and then kind of brushed it off and started talking about how they were going to grab glory. Guys, this is not unique to the disciples. I fail at this. We all do, right? We have expectations we placed on God. God, now that I'm following you, hook me up. But the right understanding, Jesus takes this moment to teach and correct his friends and us. You see, this conversation takes place right after, if you rewind or you just flip back, in Mark chapter 9 was the transfiguration. And the transfiguration is when Jesus took Peter, James, and John up to a high mountain. This is Mark chapter 9, verses 2 through 4. And as they watched, Jesus' appearance was transformed, and his clothes became dazzling white, far whiter than any earthly bleach could ever make them. Then Elijah and Moses appeared and began talking with Jesus. Wouldn't something like this, if you were one of the disciples, wouldn't this make you think, stay close to this guy? He's got an in with like the deities or God or Yahweh or however they really understood it. There's something special going on here. This guy is clearly close to God, if not God. And he is going to become the leader of the nation. They talk about this amongst themselves, and that's what led to the squabbles. Oh God, we got to start posturing for position right now. This is not something Jesus taught them to do. This is in our very human nature. Jesus never taught them scramble to the top. Kick and scratch and claw and bite and step on others so that you can have all that this world has to offer. Never once says that. Verse 9, as they went back down the mountain, Jesus told them not to tell anyone what happened until the Son of Man had what? Risen from the dead. That's verse 9 of Mark chapter 9. So they kept it to themselves, but they often asked each other, what does he mean by rising from the dead? Imagine the confusion. You hear Jesus saying, rising from the dead. You don't know about anyone rising from the dead. You haven't seen Jesus raise Lazarus yet. This isn't something that is like a regular occurrence. Furthermore, why would he be killed? We're already seeing that he's the Son of Man. He's Messiah. Peter just testified it one chapter earlier. Jesus is like no other. They saw him in his glory unveiled. They saw him speaking with Elijah and Moses, which would have been a testament or a testimony to those disciples that Jesus' ministry was authenticated, right? That he was in the line of the great prophets of the nation of Israel. Basically, they're going, we're on God's team. And if we're on God's team, let's get ready. We're going to help rule and reign. But this is where their conversation gets really crazy. Jesus asks, what were you discussing on the road? It's amazing, if you take a step back, that what we long for so often, and I don't want to put this in a way as if everyone is like longing for kingship and glory and all that, but it's amazing how often we long for things that would elevate us or give us prestige or comfort or different things. And God, every single day, actually has given us an abundance of opportunity to serve one another. Right? Like we have endless opportunities for what God actually wants for us. And then we sit around and we're like, but I want those opportunities. God knows that inside every one of us is a desire to be first, to be significant, to be worthy, to be important, to be useful. And Jesus shows us here the pathway to this is a kingdom perspective. What's so amazing is the lives that are most inspirational to every one of us are the ones that have the most Christ-like attributes. The people that are willing to literally leave it all, love it all, to the benefit of others. You know, I think about some of the great historical figures that are not Jesus. We've all seen Braveheart, right? Anyone not seen that movie? Let's put the hands that way. Right? This guy is literally believing that the freedom of man is so important that he is willing to go on the front lines of battle to help set free his people. Greater love has no one, right? And that's why he was so inspirational, and that's why people followed him. Think about George Washington. The people were only familiar with a perspective of having earthly kings, right? The monarch in England is an iron fist. And it's amazing that the people were given freedom after they won it, and they wanted to crown George Washington king. And he's saying, I've read the scriptures. You don't want a king, and you don't want me as king. That's not good. But I'll serve you. I will step up and I will serve you for some set limited period of time. These are the people that inspire us the most. They're the ones that change the course of history. So I guess the point of me bringing this up in this moment is Jesus authenticates this teaching of the transfiguration, or what happened in the transfiguration. He authenticates his teaching here that the greatest must become the servant of everyone by his resurrection. Had he not risen from the dead, we could just easily dismiss this. We could go, yeah, that was one philosophy. I guess take it or leave it, no thanks. I'm gonna go get mine, right? But the very fact that Jesus led by example, going to the cross, rising 3 days later, just like he said, we have to take this so serious. So I guess my invitation right now is just, again, a time of prayer. Is just ask God, God, is there somewhere in my life where I'm just struggling to lay down my own will? Jesus, we have so many obstacles, such busy lives, many excuses, many good intentions. Some of us have physical, practical, financial limitations, challenges. And we can trust you with all these things. We really can. But Lord, would you teach us to be servants in your likeness? This is like one of the hardest prayers to pray, because guess what? It's according to his will and he'll answer it. And very often the way that he answers those prayers, he teaches us through lessons. It's not just head knowledge. He teaches us. Would you pray with me? Jesus, make me more like you. Jesus, give me your heart. Last passage we'll look at this morning is Mark chapter 10. And this is verses 32 through 45. If we could put that up on the screen, Tony. So, moving along. This is chronological, the way kind of Mark is ordering this. And he says, now they were on their way up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. And the disciples were filled with awe, and the people following behind were overwhelmed with fear. So let's stop there. The disciples are filled with awe because they're seeing the crowds. They've seen Jesus transfigured. They have expectations. The people falling behind, they're wondering, how's this going to go? I know of Jesus. I don't know Jesus. A lot of expectation. How's this all going to shake out as Jesus comes to the capital? When it says going up to Jerusalem, Jerusalem sits up high. So this is literally like they're ascending to the capital city. Taking the 12 disciples aside, Jesus once more began to describe everything that was about to happen to him. And he says, listen, we're going up to Jerusalem where the Son of Man will be betrayed to the leading priests and to the teachers of the religious law. They will sentence him to die. You still want to come with? And hand him over to the Romans. They will mock him, spit on him, flog him with a whip, and kill him. But after 3 days, he will rise again. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came over and spoke to him. They said, teacher, listen to this. It's like they didn't hear anything he just said. Teacher, we want you to do us a favor. Jesus asked, what is your request? They replied, when you sit on your glorious throne. Didn't he just say he was going to die? They're not hearing anything he's saying. When you sit on your glorious throne, we want to sit in places of honor next to you, one at your right and other on your left. There's people laughing, right? It's so funny. It's so sad. It's so us. But Jesus said to them, he said, you do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering that I'm about to drink? Not the reply they were expecting. Then he asked, are you able to be baptized with the baptism of suffering that I must be baptized with? This is one of those moments where a lot of people go, this is hard teaching. They take a step back for those that are actually listening, right? And they say, oh yes, we are able. Then Jesus told them, basically, so be it. Your will be done. You will indeed drink my bitter cup and be baptized with my baptism of suffering. But I have no right to say who will sit at my right or my left. Talking about his eternal kingdom. God has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen. When the other 10 disciples heard what James and John had asked, they were indignant. Were they upset because of their... Well, let me ask this way. Why were they upset? Were the other disciples upset because they thought, hey, they're not understanding what Jesus is teaching? No, they're upset because they want the same darn thing they just asked for, right? So Jesus goes, okay, team meeting. Everyone gather around. I don't know why you guys can't hear me. I keep going over this. Let's discuss this again. I just told you I'm about to be beaten, mocked, betrayed, flogged, killed, and then I will rise again 3 days later, as I've told you before. Was anyone listening? So Jesus calls them together and he says, you know, friends, you know that the kingdoms and the rulers of this world operate a certain way. And the way they operate is the rulers in this world, they lord over people. They use manipulation, they use force, they use power, they use control, they use money. They use lies, whatever necessary to stay on top. They lord it over people, and officials flaunt their authority Does anyone feel like this happens in our culture? They literally lock us down and then we catch videos of them just out doing whatever? They flaunt it in our face. There's nothing new under the sun. Jesus is saying, hey, the people that rule this culture and rule this world, they lord it over you. But among you, my disciples, my followers, my faithful friends, it will be different. Why? He's establishing a different kingdom with that group right there. And he's forming into him something that we aspire to live by today. He says, whoever wants to be leader among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must be the slave of everyone. For even the Son of Man, now he states why he came. He says, for the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others. And what we celebrate this morning and this weekend is to give his life as a ransom for many. Other translations say, for all who would believe. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that I do not have to climb into this rat race, that I do not need to manipulate and kill and steal and destroy. Thank you that I can know how the systems of the world work. Thank you that you led by example, Jesus. You're not a hypocrite. But we see here the prediction, as Jesus says again, Mark 10:31-32, that clearly he's going to be betrayed, sentenced to death, delivered to the Romans, right? It's all right there. The wrong understanding for the disciples at that time and also for us is that by being in close proximity to Jesus, we're going to get special earthly benefits. Is that what Jesus ever promised us? But the right understanding, we learn right before this, every one of these teachings, Mark documents very, very closely. Right before this is the account of the rich young ruler, found in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31. Go read it. But we just listened to Jesus tell the rich young ruler, sell your possessions, give them to the poor, follow me with your whole life. Don't hold anything too tightly. Don't let it cost your soul. And the rich young ruler did what? He went away sad and sorrowful because he was unwilling to unyoke from the things of this world. The disciples had chosen to follow Jesus. Clearly, many had already fallen away. They had left houses. They had left brothers and sisters. They had left businesses. And Jesus did reward that everyone who does, did say that everyone who does those things will be rewarded. He did say that. We just have the tendency to fill in what that reward ought to be. Amen? We can trust Jesus, though. We can take him at his word that everything he asks us to do is for the Father's glory and for our benefit. And he says, but here's what's most important, is that when Jesus says this, what is deep in the human heart is revealed. Yeah, come on up, Tanner, yeah. See, a regenerated heart, which is what Jesus is seeking to instill in his disciples by faith through the Holy Spirit, right? A regenerated heart begins to think about things from a kingdom perspective, from a Jesus perspective. They no longer look at service in God's kingdom as a means to an end. Jesus and a relationship with him is the reward. We can't miss this, friends. So often we look to God for what he can give us. In fact, I would say that that's what most of the religions are built on. If this, then that. Yes, there are rewards. We're told by Jesus to store up treasures in heaven. We're told that there are many mansions, or a mansion. mansion with many rooms that God, that Jesus has gone ahead to prepare for his followers. There are many earthly blessings that God will bestow. We will have peace. We will have joy. We will have right relationships with God and one another by surrendering our life to Christ. But ultimately, Jesus is the actual reward. We see this most clearly in the book of Revelation. We don't try to get to heaven. We try to get to where Jesus is. Heaven is just Jesus' domain. See, Jesus' love for the Father and for us was so great that he gave up honor and glory. He knew what was going to happen in advance, and he marched right into it. He suffered as a criminal, but was he one? No. Jesus truly did not come to be served, but to give his life as a ransom for many. That was the whole point. That was the mission. For those that were here Friday night, we read different statements, and one of them was mission accomplished. Jesus did what he came to do. What this means, though, what does this word ransom mean? Because this is a very unique word, and we don't want to miss it. And this is the crux of the entire gospel right here. Is in Romans chapter 3, it says, for the wages of sin, or the due payment for transgressions against a holy God, is death. But the gift of God Christ Jesus is eternal life. Well, what is the gift of God? It's the good news that he forgives us when we don't deserve it, and that he has been our ransom. So what is a ransom? A ransom is a sum of money, or it's some payment that is made specifically for the release of someone in captivity. Jesus says that the Son of Man, that I, Christ, came to give my life as a ransom, as an act of service. What he's saying is, I am the payment for your captivity. In your current condition, you're literally walking around with me, Messiah. You can't even understand what I'm saying. How can you live up to my perfect standard? And yet I'm not demanding that of you. I'm demanding of you, give me your heart. Give me your life. Put your faith in me, not in your own works. Surrender. Surrender. Quit trying to play God. See, what we celebrate today is that the debt for your ransom and for mine has been paid. It's been paid by the holy and precious blood of Jesus, and it's been validated by the fact that on his own strength he walked out of the grave. Amen? The debt is, we can see the receipts of the debt being paid, because the one who said he would pay it did exactly what he said he was going to do. And all of human history has been changed forevermore. Anybody can claim to be a god, a prophet, a teacher, but there is only one who laid his life down for you and for I, and God accepted that sacrifice, and that is Christ, our risen Lord. Amen? The resurrection is not just another miracle. It is the one miracle that 100% validates every other teaching of Jesus. In John 14:6, Jesus says to Thomas, one of the disciples who we know asked a lot of questions. We sometimes give him a hard time, call him Thomas the doubter, but he wanted evidence. He was an honest skeptic. I think doubting is valid. God gave us brains. Let us reason together and see if these things don't register and make sense and add up. And Jesus says to Thomas, as Thomas is wrestling with these things, he says, I am the way and the truth and the life, and there is no other way to come to the Father except through me. However, the only way to come through Jesus to the Father is what we just read here in every one of Jesus' teachings. It's humility, right? We lay down ourselves, we lay down our pride, and we quit trying to be holy before God and for others in our own strength. We say, God, we're not good enough, but you are. So as we end this service, Tanner's going to lead us in a worship song. A little bit different Easter message than I was planning on giving. I pray the Lord spoke to you this morning. But I want you to reflect on this. If Christ is your King, and Christ is your Lord, and Christ is your Savior, and he has given everything for you, is that not worth celebrating joyously all weekend? With your whole life and giving up anything that you might be trying to hold on to? Because he has already poured out his love this wide. Jesus, we thank you. Thank you for teaching us as your disciples. God, we all have things that we don't understand and that we hold on to. Us into your ways, which are perfect and good and true and pleasing to the Father. You are not like the authoritarian rulers of this planet that lord over us and make us do things against our own volition. You invite us through an invitation of love. So, Lord, I pray that each person here in their own way would have been spoken to you by your Holy Spirit, by your Holy Scriptures this morning, and know exactly to just give their heart in response to your great love this morning. And we thank you on this very morning that you are risen, and you are risen indeed. Hail King Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Save us, rose that we would be free in you.